camera highlights in the world of sports.
Dapper Paul Runyan of White Plains, New York, tees off in the 36-hole final of the PGA Championship at Shawnee on the Delaware. Slamming Sammy Snead of West Virginia. Arriving at the green of the short fifth hole, Snead lines up a 6-foot putt. His ball misses the cup and Runyan is stymied. To have the hole, he must sink this putt, but how? After much thought, Runyan decides to use a niblick. The crowd is tense. So is Runyan, for that matter, but watch. Runyan, 5 up at the end of the morning round, tees off in the final 18. A cool, deliberate sharpshooter whose peculiar form makes his performance all the more amazing. Outdriven 30 and 40 yards by the more powerful Snead, Runyan's accuracy with short woods, irons, and particularly his putter proves the old golfing axiom that they don't pay off on the drives. Arriving at the 25th, Runyan's short pitch to the green stops within goodly putting distance of the cup. And the diminutive New York pro has the coveted PGA crown within his grasp. And there it is. The $1,000 putt that brings Paul Runyan the PGA title for the second time in his golfing career.
I think Paul Runyan was such a great short game artist because he was kind of small in stature. His long game maybe wasn't quite as good as somebody like Sam Snead, who played in the same era. Paul, I think, developed the short game out of necessity, and I think he became the best. Well, the thing that stood out the most with Paul Runyan was the fact that every time he missed a green, I was absolutely certain that he would get it up and down in two. Now, I haven't had that feeling with anybody else that I've ever played with, and he could play some of the most remarkable shots out of bunkers that I wouldn't even dream of thinking about getting up and down in two, and sure enough, he would. He was great with just little chip shots just off the green and little pitches over bunkers and things that were very, very difficult for most people, looked very simple to him.
Well, Glenn, we've got ourselves in a fairly awkward position, but fortunately we've got a very good lie. I would like to know if the green is soft or firm.
It's firm.
Firm. Well, let's have a go at it with a sand wedge because the shot requires just a straight forward light pinch with no cut shot. Remember, folks, that the three important keys to good pitching is, number one, to keep the palm of your lower hand in line with the directional position of the face of the club. Never let the right hand get behind that as it'll take the loft off the head of the club. The second important key is to address the ball where you never overreach. In this case, I'm badly overreaching. My body is too low, forcing the club to be well below the bottom of the ball. If I straighten up until my arms comfortably stretched places the head of the club even with the bottom of the ball. Then the third key is to keep your weight slightly off balance toward your front foot so that you pinch the shot. Pinching the shot is when you hit the ball a slightly descending blow. Once you've got those three keys, keep your arms soft and relaxed, make a rhythmic swing back and a slightly accelerating stroke through the shot to toss the ball softly up on the green. Well, Glenn, we surely missed being in jail by just 1 yard, but as it is, this shot is mildly complicated. This is complicated because it is a little bit of a downhill lie, and we're pitching over a bunker, a corner of a bunker. If we hit it a little too easy and it bounced and ran back in here, we might take four to get it down. We're faced also that we're pitching onto a green that slopes away from us a tiny bit. Thus, I want to hit this with the most lofted club I have, which is a lob wedge. It has 60 degrees aloft to it. In addition, I want to pinch this a little more severely, but I want the height that goes with cutting it a little. So I'm going to put the ball a little back of center, weight off balance toward the front foot a little more than usual, and then freely hit through it to get the ball softly up in the air and bring it down against the green so it doesn't get too much forward motion. I like that. Now, Glenn, I want to try this shot from a rather poor lie. I've dropped the ball so that the ball is well obscured by grass. However, the turf is relatively soft, so I'm still going to go at it with a sand wedge. I want to still have those three basic fundamentals in it. But instead of hitting it with a dead straight flight, I'm opening up to the left to allow for the fact that I'm going to open the face of the club and cut the shot a little. And I'm going to have my weight a little farther off balance toward the front foot so that I'll be going down firmly into it and getting a grip on the ball to pop it up out of that lie.
Shot. Nice shot, Paul.
I'll take that one. Loan me a ball. Let's put it in jail here for a second.
How would you treat that shot?
Well, certainly this is one that where a person has no more strength than I have. To try to play it directly at the hole is foolhardy. I've got two options. I must either turn, I can hardly see the ball, and you are allowed to part the grass enough under the rules of golf that you can see that there is a ball there. Then I would either go to the left so that if I did hit it, it has a chance to carry him and run down the hill and get on the green somewhere. Certainly my first task here is to avoid taking four from here. So if I can see where the ball is, I will then pick the club up very abruptly so I have to cut through very little grass going through it and try to get the ball just anywhere on the green. I'm making a very upright stroke and a very hard swing going through it to just pop the ball out anywhere on the green. Because it's foolhardy for anyone, even the best of strengths or the strongest of people, it's foolhardy for them to go too straight at that. Because if they dump it in here, then they've got a good chance to take four. At least there, I'm not going to take four. I've got an outside chance to make two. And if I ever made two from that particular lie, my chest is going to go out like that. I think I'm great then. This is a real nasty situation. I might use another option. I might take an unplayable lie penalty, which allows me to go within two club length, right or left, not near the hole. And I might elect to do that. If I've got the least little chance of hitting this ball out of here, particularly if I'm playing at match play, and my opponent's on the green and two, I'm going to take the gamble. But if I'm playing at metal play, I probably would drop it here and pitch it and hope to get it down in two from here to save the stroke. This just might be a shot that the good Lord himself couldn't get down in two. It involves some extreme incidents. For instance, it's a very steep downslope and with the ball very steeply below my feet. So I've got to have a very open face position to get the ball up enough to have any hopes of stopping it anyways near the flag. My weight must go well over to the left or I'll hit the shot fat. My weight must come up over it or I'll shank it because the ball's way below my feet. Once in that position, strike it with your balance as accurately in position as you can to cut the ball sharply up in the air. Now that's why I said this is an extremely precarious shot. I believe that's about as good as I could hope to do it. The most common cause of shanking is the tendency to swing the club into a convex position or get the shaft of the club and the head of the club inside your forearm. It makes it work in opposites. It goes out too far and either misses the ball altogether or hits it on the neck of the club. The correction, therefore, is to keep the tension out of your arm so that your arms will fall in closer to you, and then don't let the club head get into an inside position. Let the club stay outside so when you go through it, there's no danger of you catching the ball on the neck of the club. Now, another short shot problem is the tendency to get scared and go under or over the ball, called the yips. Now this begins by having a tendency to address the ball with the club way below the ball. Then if I did make a good swing, I'll hit the ground so far behind it that I get scared and start to flinch. But if I get the habit of addressing the ball with my arms comfortably stretched and find the weight of the club stretching my arms with the head of the club even with the bottom, then if my head stays still, I can swing it down all I want with my hands and it will catch the ball correctly. Underreaching a quarter of an inch will do much to help you stop yipping, because once you've hit a few fat shots, then you begin to get scared and do the opposite, which is to top the shot. Here, if I get scared and start to pull up, I either miss it or top it. I mustn't get my head to vary in position. I don't want to get up that way as I'm coming to it because that won't allow the club head to get under the ball. And the worse you get, the more tense you get, and it begets itself. Again, we've got to understand how to keep our head quietly in position, particularly height-wise, so that I can then swing the club down and through it with my hands, knowing that I'm not going to hit the ground too heavily behind the ball. This is a practice procedure for fun and profit in pitching. In this case, I want my weight preponderantly on my back foot so that my club will follow the contour of the earth. Then make a simple little rhythmic stroke at it and let the loft on the face of the club pop the ball up in the air and trickle on toward the hole. This uphill shot is particularly easy when the person realizes that if he keeps his body vertically, he's going to just keep pounding the club into the bank. It can't work. So you just got to, and you've got to have your feet a little farther apart so that you won't fall over. If I keep my feet together and try to put it here, I'll fall down the hill. I've got to have an anchor out here. But again, I'm just, my head is in front of right angle, but well back of vertical. And here, then I just pass the club rhythmically down and through it to pop the balls up in the air. As we move down to the foot of this slope, and we're no longer on that steep upslope, I need a change of clubs. I'm picking up the sand wedge that has 6 degrees more loft than this pitching wedge, because I need this ball to get up considerably higher because it's going to go a little farther and has to stop in the same running distance. So I've got a 56-degree lofted club now, but we still want to just swing the club rhythmically back and forth, letting it swing like a weight on the end of a string, weight a little off balance to the front foot, and then just pass it through it to let it pop softly up on the green and trickle its way toward the hole. If the lie was down a bit, where it's beginning to be into a buried position, I'd get a club with even more loft. And I've got one in the bag that has more loft than this. May I have the lob wedge, please? Because here I've got to pinch it a little more in order to get to it. This club has 60 degrees of loft to it. That allows me to pinch it enough that I'm not likely to hit it fat and still get it to pitch high enough to stay within that limit. Continuing the practice procedures for fun and profit in a little more precarious situation, I still need the extreme loft of this club plus a little more, so I'm going to open it because I'm coming off a downslope that would make the ball fly very low. So my weight's off balance to the front foot so that I can swing parallel to the ground. I keep the face of the club a fraction open and swing the club down and through it, passing it through at an angle that will not let me hit the ground behind the ball. Then if I can get a touch that is sufficiently geared to pitch the ball softly up on the green, it still should work. My weight's off balance to the left, and I'm swinging down and through it to pop the ball softly up on the green and bring it down somewhere close to the hole. All of this practice and work we've been doing for these last few days remind me of a cute story that occurred at Newport during the play of the Golf Digest Invitational. I'm practicing my pitch shots as I usually am doing, and Gardner Dickinson walks by and without pausing, he says, "Isn't it remarkable that somebody who's particularly good at something is always practicing?" And it never stopped. He kept right on going. Cases, the sand trap shot is best played with a very slightly open stance and a very slight open blade to ensure that the bouncing part of the club is down so that you are slapping the sand, that you can hit down and get a skinning shot, that it's not going to penetrate too much. When the shaft of the club is in a perpendicular position, neither forward nor back, the leading edge of this club is 15 degrees above the trailing edge. Thus, when I hit the sand, the trailing edge sclaps the ground and is called the bouncer. It makes the club bounce when it comes into it. If I got the shaft of the club too far forward, or if I turned the head of the club in until the leading edge was lower than the trailing edge, then it's a digging position. It acts like a plowshare, and the force of the swing causes the club to dig too much sand. Now, the largest percentage of our bunker shots needs the tendency to make it bounce. So we not only keep the shaft perpendicular, we open the face of the club with a few degrees, which raises the leading edge a little more, lowers the trailing edge a little more, and ensures a greater degree of bounce. And at this time, I'd like to go through some of the options that are available to you and the influence it has on the shots. For example, we're playing to a flag here that is in a reasonably confined space, but not a terribly confined one. So the shot is not a very difficult one because the bank is far enough away that I can take it out low or high and still have very little likelihood of hitting the bank unless I miss the shot completely. In this case, I'm going to play a perfectly average type of bunker shot where I'm breaking the arc just enough that the swing is going up and down in a V-like motion. And if I go up and down at the same angle and my head stays still, I'm assured that I'll come back to the same spot from which I started. Now, the thing that makes this a reasonably simple sand shot is the fact that it's in the front edge of the bunker, and if anything, on a slightly uphill lie. And the flag now is not in a precarious position for this shot, because this is going to have reasonable height, no problem with stopping it. The problem is just getting the right touch so that it stops close enough to the hole for one putt, hopefully. This is not a difficult shot. Ask me, did I like that? If I want to spin the ball, I let my weight lean up a little closer to the ball, so I hit a little closer to it, taking perhaps 15-20% of the sand behind the ball and 70-80% of it in front. That causes you to get a cushion of sand, but you're taking a larger percentage of the sand in the front, which puts spin on the ball. This ball, if I'm executing it correctly, will spin fairly hard once it gets up there. Because that, I've caught the ball as perfectly as I could catch it with that kind of a shot, and it's a very safe shot. There's very little likelihood of me topping it unless I move my body so far that I hit the ball, the bottom of the arc of the swing on the front side of the ball. The bottom of the arc of the swing is a little on the front side, but I'm still under the ball getting a good cushion of sand. Now another ball, please. In this case, I want the ball to come out higher because this bank is this deep, but it's very close to me. And the pin is even 6 or 8 feet closer to me this side. So in this case, I want to get the V to narrow so that I'm getting more of the force going down, which drives the ball up more quickly. Yes, I have to hit it harder, or I'll drop it on the bank. But once I've gotten that, I've got a type of shot that will meet the needs of the thing I've explained. Here, I'm keeping my weight a little closer to the ball, but I'm now breaking the arc, getting the V up much more abruptly, going down at the same angle, and hitting the sand a tiny, tiny bit farther behind the ball because I want to squeeze it up in the air. I want to get the ball up faster so that it comes down at a little steeper angle and with at least the same amount of spin. Now let me see if I can execute the shot where the face of the club is open to lower the bouncer a little more than normal, so that the ball comes up nicely without any danger of it penetrating and leaving it in the bunker. Now that was just about as perfectly executed as I could hope to get it. In the case of the explosion shot, the face of the club is open so that the trailing edge is down, creating a bouncing tendency. But that can't be used for any more than 20-25 yards for a weak person, or a little longer for a very strong one. Here we've got a shot of approximately 45 yards. So now we have to use a type of shot that we're going to hit the ball first and the sand later, but keep enough loft on the club that when the ball settles on the green, if I've hit it with the right power, it should stop somewhere in the middle of the green. But I'm now playing a pitch shot. I've got the ball back in my stance rather far, so that I'm reasonably sure not to hit the sand before I hit the ball. I want to be sure and hit the ball first. So I'm playing a regular pitch shot with a fairly severe pinch and a light cut. Here again, we've got a situation where the lie is moderately good, but the slope is down and the ball is a little below the feet. The problem is that I need to pitch it far enough to be sure not to leave it in the bunker. But I'm also then landing on a spot that's downhill. So this again must have a very close contact to the ball with a fairly upright swing with the face open so that you can get a little spin on the ball. You got to hit a little closer to the ball than you'd like to. But if you've done your homework and you've got a good technique, you've got a reasonable chance of hitting the ball out of this and keeping it somewhere near the hole. Two of the most common problems in the sand trap is for the student to get concerned and pull out of the shot and scull it a mile across the green. Or having done that the last time he's in the trap, taking a dive at it and chunking it and just letting it hit the bank. And the correction for both of them is the same. If you've gotten your measurement correctly, and then you make a smooth, rhythmic swing at it, breaking the arc a little bit and throwing the club down and through it, the ball pops up out of the trap and is on its way toward the target. You must be sure to keep your head quietly in position. Don't try to help the law of gravity with your head, and don't try to resist it with your hands. Keep your head the right distance from the ball. Keep your weight a little off balance toward the front foot, and then swing at it freely with your arms, and let the club head swing through it rhythmically and pop the balls up and onto the green. Keep your head quietly in position to cure both the tendency to scull the shot or to chunk it or to hit it fat and leave it in the bunker. It is a common mistake among all golfers when playing a buried lie to turn the face of their sand wedge in to make it become a digger instead of a bouncer, when they've got a club in the bag that's automatically a digger and it's got more loft than the sand wedge has. That's their lob wedge. You don't have to turn it in to make it dig. You just pick it up a little, slash into the sand, and let it bring the ball up and out of the bunker. And it'll bring it out more softly than the sand wedge will because you've retained the loft and it gets under it easily and naturally without having to turn it in. Here's a wonderful drill for bunker practice. We've got a board about 18, 20 inches long. We bury it in the sand and then drag a nice, generous portion of sand on the top of it and put the ball in the middle of it. When I make a swing at this, it brings the ball up and out without even having to swing at it hard. You get a bouncing effect. It augments the bounce of the club. It makes it a perfectly simple way to get it up. All the student has to do then is hit two or three of them from that, then back up and hit just 10% harder doing the same thing and he's got it. It's a wonderful way of getting the student to get a feeling of how the club should behave when they're playing from the sand. Time. Thanks to you all. It's been great.
We hope you've enjoyed Paul Runyan's Short Way to Lowest Scoring. Now you can build your complete game with new videos from Golf Digest. They feature Bob Toski, Dean of the Golf Digest Schools, and schools-tested instruction that has worked for golfers worldwide since 1971. Each half-hour video cassette in this new learning library series focuses on a single aspect of your game. A Swing for a Lifetime shows you how to develop one and make it repeat. Find Your Own Fundamentals lets you build a solid foundation of pre-swing basics. In Driving for Distance, you'll master the keys to length and consistency on your tee shots. Sharpen Your Short Irons will make you a crisper 5-to-9-iron player. And Saving Par from Sand will help you get up and down from greenside bunkers. For more information, just complete and mail in the enclosed order warranty card or call our Golf Digest video toll-free number, 1-800-453-4005.